The following is a special presentation of the Decibel Geek Podcast. This is the Decibel Geek Podcast with Aaron Camaro and Criss Simmons.
We're just a couple of cool dudes in loose moods, and we are celebrating Christmas in July. Welcome back. This is the Decibel Geek Podcast. I'm Aaron Camaro, joined as always by my good friend Criss Simmons, and he's in a rock and roll mood today, as always.
Doing good. How are you?
Oh, man, I'm hanging in there. It's hot as hell in Tennessee. It's hotter than
hotter
hell.
Hotter than hell.
Hotter than hell. Burning up.
Burning up with fever.
Let's just put a stop to this before it consumes the entire show.
I've had enough.
Yeah, sure, of course we have. Hey, it's Christmas in July. We're having a good time. I'm glad you guys are back with us once again. We have got a doozy for you today. Oh, man. We always try to deliver the goods, especially in Christmas in July, and today is no exception, as we are joined by the one and only crazy Joe Renda.
Yeah, and some of you will know that name and some of you won't.
Yeah, KISS fans will know it.
Well, let's do a little quick refresher for those that may not know who he is. The ones that will know who he is probably bought the book Kiss and Tell by Gordon Gebert.
Yeah.
And there was a Crazy Joe Renda chapter. And some of the stories in the interview are familiar, but some of them are not. And always better to hear it from the person themselves.
Absolutely.
And Crazy Joe was awesome to come on, and he was basically Ace Frehley, one of Ace Frehley's best friends through the glory years of KISS and into Ace's solo career.
He got to see all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, he was there behind the scenes, and he was, you know, hung out with the guys backstage. He was there when Ace decided to quit the band.
Yeah,
and some was actually involved in the talks between Ace and KISS.
Yeah,
as far as the negotiations on how he would exit the band, he goes into the detail on that. And then also talks about a song that you'll hear throughout the show called Eugene.
Mm-hmm.
And it was Ace's first writing credit after KISS.
Post-KISS, yeah.
Before Frehley's Comet. And it was basically a novelty song that Joe just came up with one day really fast. And they recorded it real quick. And, of course, you know, lots of things were consumed while recording it. And as you'll hear, a lot of stories about that stuff. But, hey, it was the 70s, you know.
Right, yeah. This Ace Frehley in the 70s we're talking about. Yeah. So, you know.
Well, and everyone in the 70s did
right.
Shit. But
I think Ace just did just a little bit more than everybody
probably
else.
Probably a little bit, yeah. But it was a party scene, and this is a party song. And it rose to attention, much to everyone's surprise. And it kind of was a bit of a radio hit at the time. And it's kind of gone down in KISSTORY lore, you know, for Ace's writing credit. But yeah, Joe just had a lot of great stories, and I'm so glad we could have him on.
Yeah, it's going to be a good one. You guys are in for a real treat today.
This is our talk with Crazy Joe Renda telling Ace stories.
So, man, you go back with Ace Frehley a long, long ways. Do you remember the first time you ever laid eyes on Ace Frehley?
Yeah, I was in my studio. I had a studio in North White Plains, New York. And like I just said, we're with Chip Taylor and John Voight, the actor.
Yeah.
And Ace knew my engineer, a guy named Chris Cassone.
Mm-hmm.
And Chris calls me and he said, you know, I ran into Ace the other day. He was living about 10 or 15 miles from the studio in Westchester County, New York. And he said, I just ran into Ace and he wants to come over and see the studio, maybe record it. I said, yeah. So that night, this Bronco pulled up, Ford Bronco, and here comes this guy. I'm looking out the window. The door opens and he almost fell down. He had these big high heels on, about 5-inch high heels. And he was like stumbling.
Yeah.
And when he came into my studio, he had to go up a flight of stairs. So he had a hard time coming up, but he comes up and, this is Ace, you know. Hey, how you doing? Yeah, I heard about your studio. The next thing, you know, I don't know. There's some things I'm kind of weird about saying, but it's happened many years ago. I guess I could say.
Yeah.
So he pulled out a big, big bag of coke.
Yeah.
He only knew me for like 2 minutes.
Wow.
And And I had a big glass table. We had a big living room upstairs. This was like a studio where you could live in while you were recording. You know?
Awesome.
So I had bedrooms and all that. We built it from the ground up. Yeah, so he emptied out about $5,000 worth of blow on the table.
Wow. That's a great way to make
friends. That's how we started out.
around what year are we talking about?
That's about 1978, 1979.
Oh, yeah, so KISS is like on top of the world when this happens.
Oh, yeah, they were big stars, yeah.
So I'm guessing you were already well aware of who he was, right?
Oh, yeah, sure. I'm in the music business for many years. I know everybody.
Yeah.
And especially he liked the idea that he could go out at night with me and drink and nobody knew who he was, which was really cool. You know, he didn't want a bunch of people hanging out with him, gawking and all that shit. So we would go out to clubs and get pretty drunk or whatever.
That's got
to just have a good time, you know, and have a lot of fun.
Right on. That's got to be one of the blessings back then for KISS was to be able to have a life afterwards, because nobody would know it was Ace Frehley unless he told them it's, hey, I'm Ace Frehley. And then half of them probably don't even believe it, right?
That's what I was going to say. When he did tell them, they would laugh at him and call him all kinds of names, you know.
Wow.
Double
edge. Especially a girl, you know, if he said to a pretty girl, hey, you know who I am? I'm Ace from KISS. Yeah, get lost.
Right?
She said, yeah, and I'm Cheryl Teagues.
So that was funny when that used to happen, because he would ask Bobby McAdams, tell them who he is, and then they would think Bobby was Ace, because Bobby looked more like a rock star than Ace did. I don't know if you ever seen the Eugene video.
Yeah, we planned on talking about
that. All right, the Bobby McAdams, the guy playing the pinball machine.
Yeah.
I blew smoke in his face. I don't know if you remember that
scene.
Yeah.
So Bobby did look more like you would think Ace would look, you know, because everybody used to try to guess what Ace looked like.
Yeah,
sure.
That whole video was a joke. We did that in about 1 hour for $50.
My name is Eugene. I'm a cool dude in a loose mood.
We did it in John Regan, you know John, right?
Yeah.
Bass player.
Yeah, he's been on our
show.
Well,
John had, he played with Ace for years, right? He called me up one day and he said, hey, my friend has his bar up here in Wappingers Falls, New York. He said, we could use it, because I told him I wanted to do a video on Eugene. So I got Bobby and a couple, the girls, one of the girls was... Cat McCord, poor girl, just passed away. I don't know if you heard of Billy Vera.
Yeah.
He wrote At This Moment. Well, that's his sister in that video.
Oh, okay.
Cat was a great singer. She sang on Eugene. She did the background, you know, Move Over, Boys, I Got Better Things to Do and all that shit.
Yeah, she's my favorite part of the video.
She had the long white hair.
Yeah.
Pretty, very pretty girl.
Very pretty.
Well, she was very... good singer, too, great singer, and up there, and we had one camera, and nobody knew anything about making a video, and we just played the record on a little boom box and a little cassette, and we just ad-libbed to it, and then cut it up, and this guy had access to the studio, and we never expected anybody to even look at that thing, you know, it was just a joke.
Just for fun?
Yeah, it was just a fun, you know, the record was starting to get some airplay up in Boston and stuff, and we figured it'd be nice to have a video.
Yeah.
I'm a musician and a producer, so, and John Regan would come down, and when we did that, we didn't even know the name of the song. I wrote a few chords, and I had an idea for like a disco track. And then Ace used to call anybody that was stupid Eugene.
So where'd you get that inspiration from?
Well, he lived in the Bronx, New York, when he was a kid, and there was a real jerk named Eugene that they would make fun of, him and Bobby McAdams. Sometime, you know, when he got high and all that, you know, and if somebody would come in the studio he didn't like or something, he would go, "Hey, there's Eugene," you know. We all laughed, you know. Nobody knew what the hell it meant, but it was really like saying, "There's asshole."
Yeah.
You know? We finished this track, and it was just laying there for a week or so. And then one night, Ace is in there, and he said, "Play the track again. I want to hear the track." He didn't play on it. And I played it, I said, "I got an idea." And I said, run that tape again. And it went, da 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 da. And I went, "My name is Eugene." And so then he goes, "Say I'm a cool dude in a loose mood." And, I mean, he started giving me all these little lines, you know. I mean, I did that, and then.
Though during that period of time, like late 70s, so of course Kiss was blowing up huge and you were hanging out with Ace. Did you get to like hang around the other guys in the band or go to any of the shows back
then? Oh, yeah. In fact, I was really, you know, the background of Kiss, Peter and Ace were friends, and mm-hmm. they didn't really like Gene. And Paul was kind of in the middle. I liked Paul. He was a nice guy, really.
Yeah.
But they didn't like Gene. And Gene didn't like them because they were completely different. You know, they liked to party a lot, and they weren't very reliable. You know, when I say reliable, I mean if there was a session, they'd probably be an hour late or whatever. I don't know. You just did a lot of crazy shit, and they always had a lot of problems with that. And I know the four of them, you know, and I became very close with Peter, Chris. In fact, Peter wanted at one time to become a partner in my studio.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, but I was afraid of that because I know I could tell you Peter Criss stories that are better than Ace stories.
Well, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I don't want to get into that, but he's a crazy guy.
I mean, although he's
a nice, good guy.
No,
good
he's
guy.
A good-hearted guy, and he's come out on the other side. He seems really, really good these days. Him and Ace both are doing great, it seems. But But yeah, in those days, they were as wild as you could get, weren't they?
Oh shit! Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, they were crazy.
You got any good Peter Criss stories you can tell us?
Well, there's one I guess I could tell it. I don't know. I never told it to anyone really, but. He had a baby, and he was going to have a christening. And he bought this big house up in Connecticut. Mm-hmm. And he invited, you know, about 50 of his closest friends, and invited me and my wife, Marie. And Ace was going to be the godfather or some shit to the baby. So he had a big spread. He got the chef from France and all that. And he had this table all full of food, and Ace to get up and make a little speech, and Ace got up and he was really drunk that night.
No.
And he threw up all over the table. Like, I was like disgusted. And Peter was really wasted, and that's when he was out of the band and Eric Carr became the drummer.
Mm-hmm.
And for some reason, he invited Eric Carr to the party.
Oh, that's awkward.
And
was he there?
And Eric Carr brought a black girl as his date.
Yeah.
Now, that's why I'm saying, I don't know if I should say that, but I don't think that went over too well.
with
Peter. He didn't kind of like that. But as he got drunker and drunker, all of a sudden, we started hearing shots fire a gun.
Holy shit.
And everybody was going, "Duck, you know, get under." I jumped on. I went under the dining room table. with my wife, and I'm hearing all these shots, and then the shots, I heard they left the house, and they were out in the woods behind his house, mm-hmm. and then they told me he was chasing the girl, Eric Carr's girlfriend, through the woods with his .357. They were shooting at her.
Wow.
Yeah, that was a pretty crazy night. And
yeah, that's crazy.
All this kind of christening. Oh, that's great.
Ace was like out of it by that time.
Oh, you know, man. Was, that's
and,
awesome.
And somebody managed to go out there and get him. Fortunately, nobody got hurt. But
wow.
Right.
Gee, that was scary when he was shooting.
Well, yeah.
I can't imagine.
There was a couple shooting incidences. The one with Ace was. There was two with Ace with guns.
Oh, really?
That were really, oh, yeah, amazing stuff. Yeah, with shooting up people and all that shit. Not hurting any. Well, I shouldn't say that. He did hit my friend's arm with a bullet.
Was he playing with
a gun? Ricochet.
Was he playing with a gun or something?
Yeah, what happened? He built this studio up in Connecticut. He bought this beautiful home, and he built this beautiful recording studio. We were recording in his new studio, and we didn't see Ace. He didn't even come to the session or nothing, but it's attached to his house. Mm-hmm. And then we started hearing gunshots again. And we looked up. There was a little staircase that comes down into the control room, and there he was with a full uniform on, cowboy hat and spurs, and you know the straps that go crisscross, you know, with bullets.
Yeah,
and two guns, and he's shooting, and all wasted out of his mind, and we thought it was blanks because who the hell would ever do that in your own studio, right?
Right.
And all of a sudden, him bing, bing, things like echoing and all, you know, ricocheting. And my friend goes, "Ow, I'm shot!" And I see his arm; he got shot. And I go, "Holy shit! It was a real bullet." If you knew Ace, he wasn't really trying to hurt anybody. Really.
Right?
He'd do anything for a laugh. You know, the thing he liked the most was going out with a couple of the guys and just have a ball, just have fun. Mm-hmm. Laugh. He used to love to laugh, you know. He had that high screeching laugh.
Oh, yeah. Famous
laugh.
I love his laugh.
I want to be a professional football player.
You good?
I want to be a butcher.
I've been working out.
If anything is an indication of what we can.
It's called the shoe polish lawsuits.
You guys.
What's your best dad?
Who's making love to your old lady?
It's like getting ready for surgery.
Getting ready for surgery.
I'm the trap player.
I mean, for the first week, though, he did have to wear diapers.
No, come here, come here. Come here.
Action!
Turn around. Look, it's rock and roll!
And now, Deep Thoughts with Gene Simmons.
Every now and then, when I get bored, I like to call up Chad Kroeger of Nickelback, and I ask him to be our new lead singer. After a few minutes of letting him gush like a little girl, I say, "Paul's never going to believe that we got Joe Jonas of the Jonas Brothers." "What? This isn't Joe Jonas? Chad Kroeger? Holy shit. Sorry, I have the wrong number."
Up to you. You guys want to hear some rock and roll, or you want to go home? See ya.
Want to be a member of the Decibel Geek Army?
You slimy scumbag, get on your face and give me 25.
Join us on our fan page at facebook.com/decibelgeek.
We love you long time.
Another log in the fireplace. It's Christmas in July.
Do you remember the time hanging out with Ace where he scared you the most?
Scare me?
Yeah, like something was going on that really scared you, like besides, you know, maybe getting shot at?
Oh, let me try it. Yeah.
Like where you thought you might lose your life?
Well, a couple of the car rides, yeah. He bought a Porsche, and he didn't know how to drive a stick shift. He said, let's go for a ride. And I got in, and, I mean, he's grinding. You know what I mean by grinding gears?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You're not getting in and making all kinds of noise. And all of a sudden, he got it going on his parkway. We must be doing over 100. And he's laughing and screaming and all that. And cops are following us now. And they put up a barricade on a Merritt Parkway in Connecticut. And I said, holy shit, you got to stop. And he goes, don't worry about it. And he broke right through and went down this bank. We almost got killed.
Wow.
And then the car came to a stop, yeah. And all these cops come running down, guns drawn and everything. And he gets out of the car and he goes, hi, how you guys? I'm Ace Frehley. Yeah. and they're all looking at each other. And I said, yeah, that's really him. He lives right here, next town up, Western Connecticut.
Yeah.
And to make a long story short, they realize it really is him. So they go, would he take some pictures with us?
Wow.
Oh, yeah. Are you kidding? I take all you want. So they got a camera out, and they start taking shots of each guy with his arm around them and hugging them. It took about 20 photos, and then, take it easy, fellas. I'm going back now. All right?
Oh,
I can't believe it. We're getting away with this shit. But we wrecked the car.
Yeah.
The car was in. Oh, shit. It was a piece of shit after that.
Yeah. Well, so you were around him when he was getting ready to quit the band in, like, the early 80s.
Oh, yeah. I remember the day he quit.
Were you with him?
I told him not to do it.
When you're going to when you're going to Ace and you're saying, hey, man, you really shouldn't quit this. This is a sweet gig. You know, you shouldn't give it up. What is his reasoning to you as to the reasons why he feels like he has to?
Remember there was a time they all put out a solo album.
Right.
He's the one that had the hit album.
Right.
The New York group.
Yeah, his
New
is the
York
best.
Group became, that's when he realized, he said, you know what? I don't need these guys. I'm having a hit album without them. I don't need Gene. I don't need Paul. I don't need Peter. I could do it myself. I said, well, I don't know. Ace, just take a break, will you? Take 6 months off. You know, tell Gene, let's all. He doesn't want to. He wants to keep working and all. I don't need it. I could do it on my own.
Yeah.
And that way, he couldn't talk. And I could see the reasoning, because he really wanted a break, you know?
Yeah.
And he wanted to play with a few of his friends. He didn't want to do the makeup anymore.
Yeah.
And that's when they did Frehley's Comet and John Regan and mm-hmm. Old Dacre and Todd and all those guys got together, you know, Richie Scarlett.
Yeah.
And that was a pretty good band, too.
Yeah, Frehley's Comet was awesome. But it took Ace a long time in between Kiss and that first Frehley's Comet album.
Yeah, because he wanted a break.
Yeah.
He just wanted to have some fun. He wanted to enjoy his house. He had a great house up in the country. He wanted to, he just wanted to hang out with his friends. And because another thing, Ace is really a rock and roller. He liked the rock and roll. And he was a good guitar player when he was a younger guy, you know.
Very much.
And, the band was getting away from the hard rock.
Oh, yeah.
Like when he did The Elder and all that stuff. And I think that bothered him a lot. Another thing, there wasn't a lot of photos in them days because he didn't want anyone to know what he looked like.
Right. Yeah.
Now, a lot of times we'd be in the studio and somebody would snap a picture with a flash.
Yeah.
And then he would go crazy. He'd say, give me that, give me that film. Especially Gene. Gene was famous for trying to grab your camera from you and shit.
Oh, did you see that in person?
Well, a lot of times, we'd go back when they were dressing, I tell you, they would have to take 2 hours to put makeup on. So a few times, I would go over and hang out with them, and then somebody would walk in a room and take a picture of Gene with half of his makeup on, and he would go fucking nuts, Give me that camera. He tried to rip it out of their hand. He wanted to throw the film on the floor. He just, instead of, Ace would just say, "Hey, you really can't do that." You know, can you give me the film? Or, you know, he would at least be nice about it.
Yeah, but it's just interesting to look back on those times because four very different people. I know Ace and Peter they would party together and get wild together, but even Ace and Peter seemed like pretty different people.
Yeah, in the beginning they were very similar, but then when Peter's drumming has started going downhill because of his, you know, drinking. That's when they started drifting apart because that bothered Ace a lot because, you know, he was a good guitar player. He didn't want somebody that wasn't keeping time and stuff, you know.
Yeah.
So I guess there was a word said. That's when they started drifting, and that's when Anton came into the picture.
Right.
And then that must have been around that time when they were trying to figure out what they were going to do for the Elder when Gene and Paul went up to Ace's studio, right?
Yeah, they actually tried to record Eugene.
Oh, they did?
Really?
You could imagine that tape. I'd love to hear that myself.
Kiss recorded Eugene?
They tried. Ace said he was laughing so hard he couldn't play.
Wow.
he said it came out like a polka.
Oh, wow.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's like funny.
That would definitely be a tape worth having.
Oh, yeah. I would love to have that.
Is Eugene available on iTunes or anything?
Yeah, you could buy the whole album on iTunes.
Ah, cool. Right on.
Or you could just buy the single.
Well, Joe, I think we've kept you for quite a long time. You got one more fun Ace Frehley story for us before we wrap it up?
Oh, man. How about the fight story? Was that in a book?
I'm not sure.
Where the Larry Holmes fight, you heard of Larry Holmes, right?
Yeah. Oh, sure, yeah.
Well, in those days, when they had a big fight, you had to go to a theater or something. You bought a ticket, and it was closed circuit TV.
Yeah.
So he was fighting, what's Clooney, the guy, what the hell is his
Jerry Clooney. Yeah.
Jerry Clooney, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he calls me up, and he said, let's go see this Larry Holmes Clooney fight. And, all right. So we go to this theater in New York, and the place was pretty crowded now. And there's about a minute to the fight to start, and he goes, I got to take a piss. So I said, all right, well, come on. It's going to start in a minute. And he goes out to the lobby, and there's a line out into the middle of the lobby, all guys waiting to go to the bathroom to take a leak because everybody was drinking beer and all that shit. So I'm yelling. I go, Ace, they're getting it. They're in the ring now. You're going to miss the fight. So he goes, I can't help it. I got to piss. He just takes out and he pisses all over. He starts pissing on the rug.
No shit.
Yeah. And all these other guys are watching him, and they do it too. There's like 25 guys pissing on this red rug. There's like a stream of yellow piss.
Oh, wow.
So he finally, you know, finished, and he runs in, and I think it was a one-round fight or something. I don't even remember. But that was pretty funny.
Oh, wow.
I'll give you one more. I just remember one. All right. Got time?
Awesome.
I mean, I shouldn't.
Heck yeah, we're going to make the time.
Eddie Solon, who was my engineer, mm-hmm. good friend of Ace's.
Yeah.
And it was, he was going to get married, and they wanted to have a bachelor party. So Ace said, let's go out and have some drinks with Eddie and Bobby and a couple other guys. So we go to this real dive, worst bar you ever seen, I mean, junk. And we go in, and Ace is drinking beer, and he tells the owner, listen, I don't want nobody in the place. Here's a couple hundred bucks. Tell everybody to leave. So there's nobody in the place but us, right, about five or six guys, we're all drinking. And Bobby McAdams and Ace, when they got drunk, would run and dive on a table until it crashed. The legs broke and everything. They love doing that. I don't know why. But they're diving and they're crashing these tables. And this old lady comes in the bar. The door must have been open. And she's sitting there drinking a beer. And Ace goes over. He goes, hey, what are you doing in here? And she goes, I'm drinking. What do you care? And he goes, well, get the fuck out. And she goes, no, I'm staying here. She goes, nobody's telling me to get out. So Ace gets up on a bar and pissed on her head.
What?
Oh, man, I never forget it. So the owner came out with yelling at him, and he goes, how much would you take for the whole bar right now? And he goes, what are you talking about? He goes, I'll give you $3,000 cash so we could stay here all night. And the guy said, you don't have $3,000. And he said, yes, and he always had a lot of money on him. And he took his big wad of money, and he paid the guy. And the guy goes, do whatever you want. And he leaves. And they started throwing pitchers of beer through the window. And, oh, my God, they completely destroyed the whole place. But it was that was funny. Wow. And then he passed out, and we only had a Volkswagen Beetle. Uh-huh. And we put him in the back seat with his legs hanging out and drove back to the studio. It was like from the knees to his shoes were the only thing you see, you know?
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, we're all like on this highway going on his Beetle with Bobby and Eddie and a couple. I don't know, it was like five guys in his Beetle. You know, the mobile. And he was passed out. We just carried him in the studio and laid him out on a bed, and he woke up, you know, 2 days later or something.
Oh, my God.
But one time, St. Patrick's Day, we used to go out on St. Patrick's Day and drink beer. And he used to like to eat corned beef, whatever they gave you, cabbage.
Yeah.
We go in his bar, and we're sitting there, and he's starving, and we're having a beer, and this girl's sitting there right next to us, and he starts eating out of her dish. She goes, ah! She starts screaming. And, like, he just takes his fork, and he's eating out of her. She don't even know who he is, right? And she's screaming, and the owner comes out, and so what's going on here? And he goes, ah, I'm just hungry. I just have something to eat, you know? And the girl's like trying to slap him and everything. So he grabs her and he starts spinning her around, and he fell with her on. they're both laying all over the floor. And now the guy wants to kill Ace. They don't know who he is, right?
Yeah.
He's coming out. The girl's half dead. There's all the corned beef and cabbage all over the place. And then Bobby is like, hey, take it easy. Leave him alone. Leave him alone. He's, you know, he's my friend and all that. And we grabbed him and we ran out. And then they came out. That's when I thought we were going to get killed or shot or something.
Wow.
But if you see, you got to see it. I can't explain it to you the right way. You got to be there to see him spinning her around when they both went down. It was so funny. Oh, my God.
Holy shit.
There's a lot more stuff. I can't even think of it. You guys kind of caught me by surprise. Yeah.
Well, Joe, I mean, because you've been awesome, and this has been a lot of fun talking to you, and I like you a lot. You're super cool. If you think of any more stories, just jot them down, you know, and you can come back on with us anytime and tell Kiss and Ace Frehley stories and stories about yourself, man. This has been great.
Oh, good. I'm glad you enjoyed it.